The name of this video is Electrostatic Dipole. This is a very important system in physics, and we are going to use it to understand, for example, dielectric materials. So it's very important to understand how the electrostatic dipole actually works. So, as the word says, this is a dipole, so it's comprised of two charges, in fact of two single point-like charges in space, one positively charged with charge plus Q, and one negatively charged with charge minus Q. In the beginning of this course, in fact, we already considered this problem and we solved it by means of the Coulomb's law for E and the superposition principle. We even sketched the field lines for this system. Let's resketch it here. So this is the negative particle minus, let's do it in red, as always, the negative one, minus Q, right here. And at a certain distance, let's call it capital D, not to get confused with differentials, we're gonna have a positive charge, let's say plus Q, here. The distance between these two charges, as I just said, let us call it vector capital D. This is the distance between the two charges. These two charges occupy a region of space, are within a certain region of space, and for generality, let's call this region of space capital omega. Therefore, if, for example, we want to observe at the point capital P enough away from these two minus and plus Q charges, this distance would be the distance R if we choose the origin of all vectors to coincide with the negative charge minus Q. And why can I choose any origin in this specific case? I can choose any origin because when the total charge Q total, in this case, given by plus Q minus Q, clearly equal to zero, then P tilde vector is equal to P, as we've seen in the previous video, that is P, the dipole moment, is independent from the choice of the origin of all vectors. So I can choose the origin to coincide, and by definition, that's what typically people do, we choose the origin for an electrostatic dipole to coincide with the location of the negative charge minus Q, so that the distance capital D is from minus Q to plus Q. This is the typical standard nomenclature used for electrostatic dipoles. Okay, therefore R is stemmed from O, and this indicates an observation point capital P in space. Now, with this knowledge in mind, if you go back at physics 242, the reason why I indicate the region capital omega space is because I want to use a little bit more formal, you don't have to, you can just do it in a simpler way, but I like to do this in a little bit more formal fashion because it's useful in many other applications later on in physics and science in general. And so these minus and plus Q point-like charges in the region capital omega space, I can write them by means of the Dirac delta, which we have seen in phys 242. And so, for example, the rho, the charge density associated with the negative point-like charge rho minus, at any point r, at point r prime, this can be written by means of the Dirac delta as the charge itself, which is minus q, times the delta Dirac at r prime. Whereas the positive charge density, rho plus, this quantity for the generic charge point r prime is given by plus q delta. This one is translated with respect to the origin, which is the center of my Dirac delta, by a quantity capital D. And so is r prime displaced by minus capital D, so displaced by D, as we already have seen in 242. With these simple definitions of charge rho minus and rho plus, which are the densities for single point charges in space. Again, I need to use Dirac delta in order to do so. Now, we can eventually write down the dipole moment P, and note that the dipole moment is the only, up to first order, is the only moment of interest. The monopole moment clearly is equal to zero. There is no monopole, so everything is dominated by the dipole moment, okay? And so the dipole moment, in this case, is by definition, the weighted average of the charge. So we know, let me rewrite the definition, that this is the volume integral in the region capital omega of space, weighted over r prime, of rho of r prime, which in our case is this superposition of the two Dirac deltas. So in other words, this quantity here, we can rewrite it simply as the volume integral over capital omega times minus Q, which comes from this distribution here, r prime, which is my weighting function, delta of r prime, dr cube, but let me put everything in a bracket, so we don't have to rewrite the sine of the integral, plus Q, r prime, which is my weighting function, delta of r prime displaced by d, so minus capital D, the whole quantity in d r prime cube. And so now we can use the properties of the Dirac delta to eventually find that P, we have seen this property in 242. The weighting function here has to be calculated at the center of the delta Dirac, which means at zero. So this does not contribute to the final integral. This property is super important. I use it all the time in my research. And so in solid state physics, in particular, is super important. So here, this delta Dirac is offset, it is displaced by capital D. So I'm calculating this function at capital D. So the result of the integral is nothing but plus Q times r prime evaluated right at capital D, and therefore the result is Q times capital D. So the dipole moment of an electrostatic dipole, P, is given by the charge times the vector D, which is the distance between the negative and the positive charge going from the negative to the positive charge, according to this definition. Now in Piazza, I want you to compute the same thing choosing a different origin, for example, choosing the Q associated with plus Q, so Q plus associated with plus Q, as the origin. So this is what I want you to do in Piazza. Of course, you should find the same result, okay, with the same conventions. Great, so now we know what is the dipole moment of an electrostatic dipole. The next thing we want to investigate is what is the electrostatic potential, and from it, what is the field associated with such a potential. Well, we know that in the case of an electrostatic dipole, since the monopole is zero, V of R has to be approximately equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, and then of course in this case, so we are already approximating it, so the monopole is gone, so the Q over R is zero, and so we are left simply with P, the dipole moment, which we calculated here, dotted with R, divided by R cube. This is the approximation when I observe the electrostatic dipole from enough distance away. All right, we also know that the electrostatic field E is equal to minus the gradient of V, the electrostatic potential. And so now we want to compute it. We know the electrostatic potential, we can compute obviously E, which is going to be minus 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, constant. And then we need to do the gradient of this ratio to function. So we can do the gradient of the numerator first. So we keep the denominator as 1 over r cube untouched. And we do the gradient instead of p dot r. And this we can sum it with p dot r untouched times the gradient of 1 over r cube. So in this case, it's one of the few cases where it is actually worth writing some of these components, for example, this p dot r in Cartesian coordinate system, whereas this one we keep it in this radial coordinate. Okay, so P dot r in Cartesian coordinate system tells us that, so in a Cartesian coordinate system, we have that P vector is Px, the x component of P, along the x-axis, plus the y component of P along the y-axis, plus the z component of P along the z-axis. Similarly, R is given by x ux plus y uy plus z uz in a Cartesian coordinate system. Therefore, P dot R, you can simply do it, is nothing but Pxx Pyy plus Pzz. Great. So now, if we were to compute the gradient of P dot R, clearly we are doing the derivative of each component with respect to x, y, and z respectively, and so multiply times the ux, uy, and uz positions, and so this one, this gradient, gives us nothing but P itself. And so eventually, our E, function of R, can be approximated as minus 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, one over r cube is untouched, and now we have the gradient of p dot r, which is nothing but p. So it goes as p divided by r cube. Great. What about p dot r? Of course, is untouched in this case here. The gradient of 1 over r cube. This one is rather simple because it's the gradient of r minus 3. R minus 3, this has to pick up a minus sign, so it's minus 3. R minus 3 minus 1 is R minus 4, so it's 1 over R to the power of 4. And since it's a gradient, in the radial direction UR. Okay, and the whole quantity multiplied times P dot R, which was untouched. Okay? So it's P dot R times minus, from the minus 3 in the denominator, minus 3, 1 over R, 4, UR. But this quantity here, we can rewrite it, eventually, as UR can be simply rewritten as R vector divided by R amplitude. And so we can divide by another R, so it becomes R5, and we put R in the numerator, and we get UR vector. Therefore, the final expression, which is typically what you find in the books, for E of R, we bring this minus sign within the integral, within the bracket, sorry. And so this one is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. This minus becomes plus. And so we get 3 times p dot r, which is a scalar, direction given by r. So plus 3 times, this direction is r, p dot r divided by r to the power of 5. So this is the radial component of the field, of the far field, okay? Minus p, the component of the field divided by r cube, which has the direction of the dipole when I observe it from far away. And so here, we know that for an electrostatic dipole, since the monopole is zero, the electrostatic potential V of r is given by this expression, 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught p dot r over r cube. From the derivation, from the gradient, the electrostatic field has two components. One is radial, 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, 3 p dot r over r5, radial. The other one, it goes along p, minus p over r cube. Potential and field associated with an electrostatic dipole, very important results. Actually, this is, we use it quite often, okay, also in research. So to summarize this video, here I introduce a very important concept, that of electrostatic dipole, which is comprised of a minus Q and a plus Q single point line charges in space. I like to write these charge densities using the Dirac delta in this fashion. Therefore, it's straightforward to compute P from the definition of weighted average, which allows us to find that P is equal to QD independent from the origin for an electrostatic dipole. And you should do it for a different origin. as a cross check. You can put the origin wherever you want, okay? You can put anywhere you want, and you should find the same result. So then eventually, from the electrostatic potential, which in this case only has the dipole moment term because the monopole is gone, it's zero, by doing the gradient, we found the electrostatic field, and we found these two important results for V and E respectively. And so again, I know the student makes some confusion because in two videos ago, we had a discussion about the multiple series expansion where there is a monopole, a dipole, etc. terms. And this one is called the electrostatic dipole. They are somehow related, not the same thing, but they are related. So you should meditate a little bit about that. So the fact that it's called electrostatic dipole and the fact that the P is also called a dipole moment, they are somehow related. And eventually, I hope to come back to that at some point in time. But they're not exactly the same thing, so don't make confusion about that. So the dipole moment for the electrostatic dipole is QD. The dipole moment itself in general, it's given by this definition, which can be applied to any system you want, not only to an electrostatic dipole, to any charge distribution you want. That's it.